Hi, this is Steve from ACCAAEPC.com. What we're going to do today is we're going to look at the just-in-time system. It's also called JIT system. Within the JIT system, of course, there are particularly three aspects that we're going to look at. Firstly, what is the JIT? And secondly, the key elements within the JIT in order to be successful using the JIT system in the real life. And thirdly, about some of the common bits about its advantages as well as the disadvantages with regards to the JIT system. So firstly, what is the JIT system? JIT system is where we're going to ensure the right quality as well as the quantity of the products in place at the right place and also at the right time, which means when the customer orders goods from the company start manufacturing it using the same quality of raw materials each and every time, and then manufacture the products and finished goods to be sold to the final customer at the right quantity. Otherwise, the customer will return the goods back to me, yes, if the quality is not good, if the quantity is not right. Or maybe if there's any delay in producing a product and delivering the product, and the place is not right, of course, customers will return the goods back to me. And hence, I need to bear extra costs in relation to that. So from that perspective then, what the JIT system is going to do, it is saying that we're going to minimize or eliminate the inventory within our company in order to save costs. We need to use one or two suppliers supplying us for the raw materials at the very good quality or standard quality, or to make sure that the quality is okay and we're very consistent in each and every material, and then we have a close relationship with the supplier, and the supplier is close to our company in order to save the transportation costs, for example. So that we can, our aim for that is to try to improve the efficiency within the whole factory. And the JIT system can be split into the purchasing as well as the production. What do I mean by purchasing over here is that we're talking about when the customer orders a goods, then we're going to produce it, purchasing the raw materials, and then we're going to pass the raw materials into the production department to produce it. And also, when talking about the purchasing, we need to make sure that the quality of the raw materials is good. Otherwise, of course, the customer will return back the goods to our company, and our company will have to bear the costs in relation to that. When talking about the production over here, we are talking about some examples. The previous example I've given you, within the factory over here, there are lots of processes. The process number one, design, process number two, painting, process number three, inspection, and deliver the final product to the final customer. And the capacity in each of the business processes will be quite different. So for example, in the business process number one, the capacity is just to be 200 units. But process number two is 500 units. Process number three is to be 400 units, for example. And hence, you're going to buy all of the raw materials in the first place. Yes, that would be no problem. Buy 200, spend that, trying to pass that to the process number two. But here, in this case, the maximum capacity of the process number two is to 500, but you only pass 200 into the process number two. There would be a spare capacity of 300 that is not being used by the company. And hence, that would be not quite efficient. So from that perspective, what the company is going to do is that seeing this particular situation happen, of course, we're going to maximize this purchasing of the raw materials at 500 rather than 200. But here, from the process number two to process number three, if you're going to pass all of the work in progress to process number three, only 400 units can be produced at the same time. So from that perspective, 500 over here, and hence what you're going to do as a management, you're going to think about to maximize this particular capacity, it would be the process number 300 to 500 to match that against the process number 2, rather than increase the individual capacity for each of the processes. And hence, that's what I mean by production. Any ways that we can do that is where we're going to calculate the throughput accounting ratio. Of course, you have learned that in the early section, in the early papers, so that the examiner is not quite interested in it, in this paper. But that's the idea you have to know, okay? So we know what's a JIT. The next question is, if you want to start a company and you want to implement the JIT system within your company, what are the key elements that you have to follow them? Of course, the key element, I have my own mnemonic, is called PRAISE. As I say to my students, that not every business on the planet can use the JIT system. Okay, so we need to see that the key elements within your organization that can use the JIT system is called PRAISE. So let's see what the characters would mean. So P stands for pull approach, which means it is not the same as the push approach. What do I mean by pull approach? Is where we're going to focus on the customer. If the customer orders a goods from our company, we're going to start manufacturing it, and then sell the goods to the customer very, very quickly to eliminate the inventory. A push approach is where we have lots of inventory in place firstly, before they get sold to the final customer. Okay, so they are not the same. Second R stands for the receivable days. The receivable days should be matched with the payable days. I'm not saying that they should be exactly the same, but rather they would be nearly the same. So what do I mean by that is, for example, we have to buy the raw materials, manufacturing it to the finished goods before we sell it, collect the receivable. From that perspective, payable days is what we refer to as we are dealing with the suppliers. So for example, we order the goods on 1st January 2014, that's fine, from the supplier, and we're going to pay for the supplier, settle the payable to the suppliers on 6th January 2014, which means 5 days later, we're going to settle the invoices in relation to that. And at the same time, we are going to deliver this particular product to the customer on 3rd January 2014, and the customer will pay for us on 7th January 2014. As you can see, that the receivable days, receivable days is, from, 1st January, the 3rd January to 7th January is 4 days, isn't it? It's the days before we collect the money from the customer. And here, the payable days is 5 days. As you can see, 6 minus 1. So from that perspective, 4 and 5, nearly match against with each other. Of course, you can use the JIT system in this case. Also, we need to look at the other criteria. So PRA is what referred to as any of these activities that's non-value adding. Of course, we need to eliminate those activities. For example, setup times, inspection time, move time, etc. So those are the non-value adding activities. We have to wait for something to happen, but do nothing about it, for example. And hence, those are non-value adding activities. What we're trying to do is to minimize or decrease them to a certain acceptable level. PRA, the next thing is the I, we're going to eliminate the mentoring within the company. So for most of the JIT systems, companies that are using the JIT system, they're going to eliminate the inventory because they think that the inventory will, you know, cost the money. So the example is storing the inventory will cost the money, okay? Holding the inventory will cost the money. So what if the inventory gets damaged? But next argument would be, well, if you haven't got enough stock or inventory within your warehouse, you will have the run, you know, the stock out costs, which means it may be possible for you not to have enough, you know, inventory to be produced as the finished goods to dispatch to the final customer. And hence, as a result of that, of course, if the stock out happens, of course, you haven't got enough inventory to be sold, and hence you will lose potential sales revenue, and that will be your opportunity costs. So for most of the businesses nowadays, of course they're going to have some of the inventory within their warehouse as a buffer stock, but you know, from the JIT's perspective, it argues that the stock will cost you money. But anyway, you need to balance the risks of running out of stock. So for example, for some of the customer will order the goods from you, at a very large amount of orders, quantities, maybe, yeah? So from that perspective, it's uncertain, I should say. And from that perspective, maybe you should hold a certain amount of inventories within your warehouse before you run out of stock, and that's what I mean. And also for some of the companies in some of the countries, yes, that's lack of natural resources. So for example, some of the countries in Africa, some of the countries in Asia, etc. Of course, their countries is lack of resources. And what you're going to do, instead of holding no inventory, what you're going to do is to hold it. Because, well, maybe if you run out of stock, you're going to order the goods from the, you know, overseas suppliers, and you have to wait for a very long time. Yes, before the goods can be dispatched to your country. And hence, of course, you need to make sure that you've got enough inventory within the warehouse before you can sell it. So that's why the inventory, you know, elimination is just to try your best. And also you need to balance the risks and uncertainty, and also the cost and benefit associated with that. PRAIS. The next S stands for suppliers. So what suppliers going to do is that you need to make sure that the suppliers is reliable. Okay? The quality is reliable. Okay, otherwise, of course, bad quality of product, the customer will return the goods back to you, and hence, of course, it will damage your reputation. And also, they're not far away. Because if the supplier is quite far away, overseas suppliers, how can you use the JIT system? Maybe you can't use that. Well, for some of the companies, famous companies, their suppliers using the JIT system, their suppliers are within 100 miles. Yes, next to their factory. And hence, of course, save a lot of cost in buy the raw materials and manufacturing very quickly. So, the final E stands for easy. It's not referred to as the easy product, easy manufacturing process, no. But rather, what I'm trying to get at here is that what I refer to as, you know, there's a small production line. Instead of having thousands of products, you have to import the raw materials from thousands of suppliers based in different countries, for example. It's very hard for you to use the JIT. But rather, having a small production line, for example, at the McDonald's, you've got hamburger, etc., etc. Of course, you can get those raw materials fairly quickly with those small product lines. Maybe 10 products, 5 products, acceptable, that'd be no problem, yes? So those are the elements in making sure that the JIT system is implemented successfully within your organisation. That's the second part. Okay. Right. The The third part within the JIT system is where we're going to have a look at some of the comments part related to that. Is that good or bad? That's where we're going to focus upon here. So, when looking at the comment part of the JIT, of course it's good, it's simply because instead of holding lots of inventory, but now you're going to hold none of the inventory, and it will decrease your working capital requirements. Okay? You don't have to tie up a lot of cash in place. Yes, you don't have to spend lots of cash buying the raw materials, but rather customers order the goods and then you're going to purchase it and then manufacturing it and then sell it, and then you're going to collect the money from a customer fairly quickly, match with the payable date. And from that perspective, you know, it's good, isn't it? It can lower down the working capital requirements for the company and improve its liquidity position. And also, it will save a lot of space. Instead of having lots of, you know, factories storing the raw materials in place, what you're going to do is that you're going to have, you know, lots of spare spaces there, not to store any of this inventory. So from that perspective, of course, it's a benefit for you. And of course, you can better meet the customer's individual needs. What do I mean by that is that instead of having a push approach, we're going to have a lot of inventory in place before we sell it. Of course, before the customer orders goods from our company, we have manufactured lots of inventory into place, yes? And those inventory will be, I mean, the same style, yeah? Maybe the customer does not want it. And hence, what I'm going to do is to use the pull approach, which means we're going to use a JIT approach when the customer orders a goods, maybe a specific kosher product, then we're going to start manufacturing it, sell it to the final customer, and that will, you know, better meet their needs, and that would be the advantages then. But it's good, fine, but also it's bad, because JIT is very complicated, and a lot of things needs to be done. So firstly, you're going to focus upon the suppliers. You're going to rely on the suppliers. If you are going to rely on the suppliers is so powerful because no one else on the planet can offer you the same quality of raw materials. And hence, if they're so powerful, of course, they can increase the prices up fairly easily. And hence, because they're so powerful, you have to listen to them and there will be a cost burden for your company. And also, there are a lot of difficulties in finding those appropriate, or what I refer to as reliable suppliers. Reliable suppliers, of course, is very hard to find because some of the suppliers are so unethical. They're going to take your money, produce the, you know, send the bad quality of raw materials to you. This happens quite a lot in the real life, and that's why we're going to need the inspection departments, for example, quality check departments, for example, to focus upon their qualities. So it's very difficult for you to find those reliable suppliers. And also, it will increase the costs for your company. It will increase the quality costs for your company. So for example, costs associated in training those employees, yes, to be aware of the quality issues, and hence, of course, that would increase the cost for the company because more expenses in expense in training, also spending more expense in inspecting the quality of the goods, and hence this will increase the cost burden for your company. If there's any delay in the raw materials that is sent by the supplier to your company, as a result of that, is that good or bad? If the supplier is far, far away. Of course, if this is the case, well, you can't just to collect the, you know, collect the order from the customer and then you're going to start manufacturing it. You have to wait for a very, very long time before the raw materials comes into your company and then you start manufacturing it. And from that perspective then, of course, this this doesn't meet with the elements within the JIT system as we see before. So that any of this delay needs to be eliminated is very, very important. Also, when using the JIT system, we are focusing on the multi-skill workers rather than a worker doing the same job again and again. But rather, what we're trying to do here is where we're going to train each of the employees within the company to deal with multitask. Not only are you going to deal with the painting, but maybe you're going to deal with the inspection. That happens quite a lot. If you look at Toyota, for example. And hence, of course, in training those multi-skills workers, of course, that will cost us money, and hence it will be a cost burden for the company. And also, we need to make sure, because the JIT system is split into the purchasing and production. When looking at the production, it is very important for you to eliminate any of this inefficiency within your organization. So one way you can do is trying to increase the efficiency from the whole factory's perspective, not just to increase the capacity within each of the processes. And hence, if there's any process, business process that's within the factory has lots of capacity compared to the other one, of course this will lead to any of this lack of the inventory, yeah, being produced at the same time. And hence, what we're going to do here is that we're going to use, for example, some of the appropriate measures in place. For example, it's like the frugal accounting, so for example, in making sure that the whole factory as a whole, yes, is efficient. If this is not the case, if this is not done, of course, your JIT cannot be successfully implemented within your company. So those are the common parts you can comment on in the exam, and we finish off the JIT.